People. It's a very unusual setting for me too, but I hope you will enjoy the speech today. Actually, I wanted to surprise what it is about, but now the surprise is already told. So we shouldn't have talked about that before. Because when I was asked to talk about crossover, I thought about, well, I could deliver a lot of things about that. Born Dutch, living in Austria, grown up in Austria, grown up in the mountains, living in Vienna, married into a big Romanian family. That would be crossover, for example. But I thought there is nothing better to talk about crossover because I can talk about politics. This is a demonstrant in Ukraine called Ruslana. Now can it, I already can say it, she won the Eurovision Song Contest 2005. I can talk about performances. I can talk about wind machines. I can talk about voting. I can talk about tradition. You remember the babushki from Russia 2012? I can talk about television. I can talk about tolerance. I can talk about Europe. I can talk about pop music. I can talk about languages and cultures. I can talk about charts, about gay pride. I can talk about San Marino. You know San Marino, it's beautiful. And I can talk about hosting a huge event like this is Baku in Azerbaijan. Yes, I am going to talk about the Eurovision Song Contest. So, I was already told that I'm a huge fan of the Eurovision Song Contest, and I just want to explain why it is like that. I was 7 years old when I saw my first Eurovision Song Contest, and I never missed any since then. That was back in 1976. Yes, I'm a fucking old man. Yeah, I know. It was back in 1976. My parents just moved from the Netherlands to a town called Bad Ischl in Austria, and I was watching the Eurovision Song Contest, and the host city was the city where my grandparents did live. It was Den Haag. So suddenly, I was sitting in Austria, in the mountains, watching TV and seeing the city of my grandparents. Since then, I'm a European and I love the Eurovision Song Contest. And since 2010, I am there at the Eurovision Song Contest itself. In 2010, just as a fan. 2011, I was part of the Austrian delegation when a singer called Nadine Beiler did sing in Düsseldorf. And then I was, since 2012 in Baku, also because of political reasons, because I'm also a member of the Austrian Parliament, which is not very interesting today, though. I was also blogging for Der Standard AT, because Azerbaijan, you know, was a quite interesting thing to tell about, to talk about the system there, the political system, and a democracy movement which wanted to use the Eurovision Song Contest to get a stage for their ideas. So since then, I'm blogging for the Standard AT, which you can still read. Actually, my speech today is based on one blog entry I did at the Standard AT. Why do I want to talk about Eurovision? Well, Vienna hosts the next one. That's already quite a thing to talk about, right? But also, even in Austria, even if it changed now because we won, right? We were always the losers, and now we won. And because we were always the losers, many people thought, Eurovision, who does need that? Who wants that? It's boring. And I heard a lot of times, this year was the first Eurovision I've watched since ages. But I think the reason of that are the dark ages. The dark age of Eurovision are the 80s. I mean, they are for a lot of reasons, fashion, for example, right? Dark ages, definitely. And since then, the Eurovision isn't seen that serious. But I give you a hint. take Eurovision very serious and you'll have a lot of fun. If you don't take it serious, you won't have fun, you know. And in this dark ages, all these prejudices came up about the Eurovision Song Contest, and also in the 90s, when suddenly there were big changes in Europe, you know, the Berlin Wall and stuff, and the Eastern Europeans joined the Eurovision family, and since then it grew even with all the prejudices. So this is actually what I want to talk about, the 12 biggest prejudices and misunderstandings about the Eurovision Song Contest. You see, the cup changed. I gave 12 points to Denmark. I mean, Conchita won there, right? So the first prejudice, the Eurovision Song Contest is just political. It's not about music. Well, countries competing against each other. There is always a political part of it, even if you don't want to. Take football as an example. Football declares itself as non-political. And then imagine a match, Iran versus Israel. You know what I mean? You got the point? This is why when countries are competing against each other in a quite diverse and difficult continent like Europe, there will always be a political point. But the most important thing is the Eurovision Song Contest was founded even as a political idea. It was founded by this man. He is a Swiss guy. He's called Marcel Besançon. And he had this idea in the post-war Europe, we shouldn't fight against each other anymore. We should sing and dance together. You know, and in the 50s, a lot of these things happened, like the first idea of the European Union came up. So, and Marcel Besançon had this idea, we do in a new media format, which was called television, you know, which was getting broader and broader. We will dance together, make one big show for the whole of Europe. It didn't exist before. So he had this idea. So actually the idea of Eurovision is already quite political. By the way, there behind there is a man who is researching that on the University of Vienna, all the political stuff around Eurovision, Dean Vuletic. So if you want to join at the university in his seminars, you will learn much more of Eurovision than on this speech today. There have always been a lot of political issues. A lot of people think that 2014 was the most political contest. Conchita won, and she had a message, a very political message. And then there was this thing with the Ukraine and Russia. With Russia, we also had this thing about the new anti-gay law. That's why you saw so many rainbow flags waving when the Russian teenage girls were singing. But this is not new. It's really not new. 1968, for example, Spain, which was still under the rule of Franco, so a fascist regime, to say, there was a song which should be sent to the Eurovision Song Contest called La La La, and it had to be sung in Catalan. And Franco said, no, we don't send a Catalan song to the Eurovision Song Contest, it has to be Spanish. So he did send the same song, but sung by another woman, but in Spanish. And by the way, she won. And 1974, the Portuguese entry, that was the Eurovision Song Contest when an unknown group from Sweden called ABBA did win. In 1974, there was a song, a Portuguese song, and it became the anthem of the Carnation Revolution in Portugal. It was the anthem of the revolution. We have heard songs about peace when there was the big peace demonstrations. You remember Nicole? Ein bisschen Frieden, ein bisschen Sonne. You know? We had songs about nuclear weapons. We had songs about the Orange Revolution in the Ukraine. And we had songs where an Israeli and Arab singer were singing together for Israel. Or we had a Georgian entry, 2009, for the Eurovision Song Contest in Moscow. And the title of the song was, very clever, I Don't Wanna Put In. They were not allowed to join, by the way. That was too much for the EBU, that's the European Broadcasting Unit. They were not allowed to go there, so Georgia was not allowed to be in Moscow for the Eurovision Song Contest. So, yes, this prejudice is totally true. The Eurovision Song Contest is not just, but it's very political. It's not about music, it's just bizarre performances. Oh, yes! Oh, yes, that's true. It's partly true. The funny thing about Eurovision is, you know, in sports events, when countries are competing, you can see who did score the most goals or who were the fastest ski driver or something. There is something, you know, subjective. Objective, sorry. In Eurovision, it's about taste. It's unpredictable. And this is the nice thing about Eurovision. We had songs who had a very quiet performance. No dances, no chorus, no pyrotechnics, no acrobatics, and they did very well. Just remember, I don't know, Belgium 2010, Tom Dyes, or Anouk 2013 for the Netherlands, or even Conchita Wurst 2014. She was alone on stage. There was no dancer, no choreography, no nothing, and she won. But, of course, we have the entries, you know, with bizarre choreographies, with dancers, with fire, with whatever. And to be honest, that is why we love the Eurovision Song Contest. And it's really fun. And I mean, do you know any other event where you have the chance to listen to an Estonian singer? I don't know any, no other event where it's possible to do so. The third one. It's only about wind machines. Well, that's true. I don't have anything to add. That's simply true. Fourth, the block voting is so annoying. Well, I have to admit, if you know already before the Eurovision Song Contest that Cyprus will give 12 points to Greece and vice versa, it is kind of annoying. It's true. If you see that, let's say, the ex-Yugoslav countries, so the Balkan countries, or the ex-Soviet countries, or the Scandinavian countries, always give each other the points, you could say, yes, it's annoying and it's block voting. But it's worth to have a deeper view into that. Is it really just about politics, about friendships, about neighbors, about, you know, block voting? I don't think so. The problem with Austria is the same. The Netherlands too has this problem, Belgium does has this problem, or Slovakia or Hungary. They don't have this cultural region which is bigger than the country. So what I wanted to explain is, the Scandinavian music market is already a one market. So if you become a star in Norway, you are a star in Sweden. The same on the Balkans. Let's take Dino Merlin, a very famous singer from Bosnia, who did sing for Bosnia 2011. He's a huge star in Croatia, Serbia, or Macedonia. Or if you're an ex-Soviet singer, of course, you have a huge success in, I don't know, Belarus or Armenia. So it's not just about block voting and political things. It is really also about cultural sharing, I would call it. So yes, the block voting will always irritate us, but even a country like Austria can win at least. So block voting doesn't make a Eurovision winner. That's the most important message for you. Here I just want to show you 2008, I didn't like the song. A Russian song that went was from Dima Bilan. And here you see, you can find a lot of graphics like this in the internet. You can see from which countries did he get the most points. And why did Russia win back in 2008? And you see, as closer the countries are, the bigger the stripes are. So this is just to illustrate the idea of block voting. Five, no one needs Eurovision. Let's eliminate it. Well, yeah, I'm always surprised about the hatred about Eurovision. I mean, I'm blogging at the standard AT, so I'm always surprised that so many users who say they hate Eurovision are reading my articles and then to post the comment that they hate Eurovision. I mean, if I don't like, I don't know, table tennis, I'm not reading all articles about table tennis and then commenting why I don't like table tennis. So why about Eurovision? I really don't know. And I have a hint for you, but keep it as a secret. You don't have to watch Eurovision. You can do something else. You can read a book. You can have a candlelight dinner with your beloved ones. You can have, you know, whatever you want. You can watch a movie or, I don't know, Game of Thrones. You don't have to watch it. What's the problem that people do love it? What is the problem that between 150 million and 119 million people do love to watch it? What's it about that, and isn't it something special, Eurovision? What do we have in Europe in common? What do we share with all European countries? Well, we got politics and we got sports. And then? We got Eurovision. It's the only event there are people in Reykjavik and Tel Aviv, where people in Minsk and in Lisbon, where people in Vladivostok and in Vienna are watching the same thing, commenting the same gossip, dancing, making parties. So I really think that if the Eurovision wouldn't be invented yet, we should invent it now, really. And if you're there in a host city, you will hopefully experience this next year. If you see an Albanian family, you know, grandma, parents, children, dancing together with, I don't know, teenage girls from Azerbaijan and a group of gay bears from Spain, dancing together, there is no other event on the whole planet I know where this can happen. So this is really something special, and I hope you will enjoy that next year. You can buy this t-shirt, by the way, in a Eurovision fan shop. Well, this is a little similar. But what always a surprise for me is really that people do watch it to hate it. There must be something with Eurovision, right? That people are watching something just to make bad comments about it, to say how bad it is, how bad the music is, or whatever. I really didn't get it anyway, but I already told you, don't have to watch it. I love that one. No telly? So you don't get to watch it. This is Johnny Logan. He won the Eurovision Song Contest 1987 with Hold Me Now. The next prejudice, which you heard here since mid-90s, I would say. Since the only Eastern European countries are participating, there's no chance for a Western country anymore to win anyway. Always the Eastern European countries are winning. You hear this really a lot of times. And I read it a lot in the comments on the standard AT. So it's helpful to have a closer look. Who did win the last 20 years? You know, the revolutions 25 years ago, step by step, the countries joined the Eurovision. So who did win the last 20 years, which are 21 victories, of course? Well, we had 7 Northern European victories. If there is a mafia at Eurovision, it's Scandinavia. Definitely. And I don't mean this, I mean, I love them, yeah. We had 7 Northern European victories. We had 5 Eastern European victories. We had 3 Western European victories. 2 Southeastern Balkan victories, you know, Greece and Serbia. 2 Middle European victories, which were Germany and Austria. And still 1 victory belongs to Turkey, which is, you know, an island on its own, which unfortunately isn't participating anymore. But that means the last 20 years, we got 5 Eastern European victories and 16 from the rest of Europe. So this is definitely wrong. I love that image. I couldn't resist to put it inside this one. Eurovision doesn't make careers. Eurovision is destroying them. You know these guys, huh? It's ABBA. Well, of course, Eurovision has made a lot of success. The most covered song ever in the whole history of pop music is a Eurovision song, but just no one just remembers it. It's the Italian entry of 1958, and it's called, and I know you know it all, Volare. It didn't win, so that means that not you don't have to win Eurovision to have a big success, right? Of course, we had Udo Jürgens, we had Cliff Richard, we had ABBA, we had Céline Dion. No one knew Céline Dion in 1988 when she won for Switzerland. So Eurovision made a lot of careers, but I'm honest, just a small percentage really can start a worldwide career. But this is with all this pop music events, you know. You know, it doesn't matter if it's a national casting show or a worldwide or European event. But to make it clear, the problem is the approach of different countries towards the Eurovision Song Contest. I always take as example the Netherlands. The Netherlands, no good artist from the Netherlands did want to be part of Eurovision because it destroyed my career. And then Anouk came 2013 to also prize a huge star, and she did very well. And now suddenly, all big pop stars want to be Eurovision stars. They want to join there. So it can change very quickly. And we will see how this will happen after the victory in Austria, because the Eurovision, no Austrian artist wanted to be part of Eurovision. Only unknown artists, let's say. And a lot of artists, and this is a very important message which people don't realize, they join Eurovision, but they do not plan an international career. They want to have a career in their region or in their country. For example, the Turkish winner from 2003, it's always a good example, Sertab Erener, is forgotten meanwhile in complete Europe, but she still makes fabulous albums which are very popular in Turkey or in Azerbaijan, and she can still fill arenas for the Turkish market. So even if we think they don't make a career, they actually do it. So I have to hurry up a little bit, otherwise someone is getting a little nervous. The other thing is Eurovision is just commercial. You hear this a lot, you know, people who like indie music, and I like indie music, but I also like trash music. But if you are at Eurovision, you talk about with the artists, you're sometimes really shocked about the precariat they live in. They come there and they didn't earn any single money just with joining the Eurovision. Even winning doesn't mean that you didn't earn any single euro. And it's even worse in countries like Moldova. This is the Moldovan group Stop Shidup from 2012. They're a fantastic punk rock band, by the way. They sang together with the Red Hot Chili Peppers. They're really good. And their Moldovan entry, this someone told me last year it was 2 years ago in Malmö, that the band have to pay the half of the costs. The other half is of the broadcaster, of the television. So they have to pay to be part of Eurovision. So I think to talk about commercial thing isn't such a good idea. 10th one, Eurovision is just a gay pride. Well, this is the winner song of 1961. It was a French guy called Jean-Claude Pascal, and he won with Nous les Amoureux, fantastic song, YouTube it. It was the first song, they say, about gay love. It was not very open, of course, but it was about a secret love. And since that, it's declared, the whole Eurovision Song Contest is declared as a very gay thing. Well, one thing is true, and I have to admit, you know, as a gay person myself, yes, it is very gay. I mean, choreography, beautiful costumes, who do love that? That's also why we don't see that much lesbians, by the way, and more the gay guys, you know. But it's not a gay event. This is a very important thing, even for the gays who are going there. No one wants it as a gay event. It's just about that you can be what you are. This is the most important thing. So even if 70% of the people going to Eurovision from the fans, you know, are traveling there, they don't want it as a gay event. So this is one of the biggest misunderstandings. You should be able to be open gay, but you don't have to be gay, you know? This is the important message of Eurovision. It's open to the 11th. 2025, San Marino will be represented by Valentina Moneta. Well, we have seen her 2012, we have seen her 2013, we have seen her 2014. Yes, it's possible. So, actually I changed the numbers, sorry. And this is the last one, actually. No one wants to win Eurovision because it's too expensive to host it. Well, this is a serious thing. If you talk with delegations when you're at Eurovision, and suddenly they're in a favorites position, like Austria last this year, you know, they are really getting nervous. Because for the broadcaster, I mean, at least it's our television broadcaster who sent the entry, they have to pay really a lot of money. For example, the Norwegian public broadcaster, and Norway is not a poor country, right? The Norwegian broadcaster, NRK, they couldn't broadcast the World Cup from South Africa because they had to pay for the Eurovision Song Contest, so they couldn't bid. And we had huge events in Baku and in Düsseldorf, where they paid millions, millions, millions of euros or whatever you want, manat in Azerbaijan. It's very, very expensive to host the Eurovision Song Contest, and it's true that the delegations are very scarce. But we will see how the Austrian broadcaster ORF will do this next year. Malmo and Copenhagen tried to downsize Eurovision a little bit after this huge, bombastic, megalomaniac event, especially in Baku. They have a different political regime as well, which has to do with that, of course. But we will see how they will do it, but I'm quite confident, and I wish you all much fun at the Eurovision Song Contest in Vienna and building bridges with this very good thing, with a crossover thing, I thought. So thank you. Thank you.